Thank you, and Jack has agreed to let me start, and it's been interesting. We've got a lot to cover. I sometimes try to go too broad. I'll try to move very fast. I will not read everything to you, in case you're wondering. If you can find the copy that does say Jazz Band Tips and Beyond, I'll start with that. Jack and I, through about 30 emails and, you know, about 2,400 miles apart, put this together, but we decided just to have separate halves, kind of. So I'll take my shot at it here, and then he can take over. It's interesting, the different approaches we have, too. I guess I learned as we went along. I think, in some ways, may not even agree on some things. And I do want you to ask questions, or maybe you have better ideas. With this group here, I present to you, and you tell me what may work better for you, what doesn't work off this list. I would love to see that, too. I've taught 25 years, and we've taught 40, whatever. So I'd like to learn. But I'll continue, and some things I will read along with you. I like to start from kind of a philosophical standpoint. I guess I don't often like to do things that I don't believe in, or I don't have some kind of foundation. And I buy into the fact that, yes, jazz is part of American history, part of our heritage. Maybe some people don't get that much thought that I studied jazz intensely in college and just obviously loved it and the way really got into it. And it's always been a part of my own life and my instruction. Some of you have heard that phrase, what will be remembered from America forever, baseball, jazz, and the Constitution, right? 1987, some of you may not know, U.S. Congress declared jazz as national treasure to be preserved, promulgated. There's some policy on that I think you'll find interesting. And so if we decide that children or students should have some instruction in this area, then we should discuss this. Well, maybe at most conventions, I think we should have some kind of venue for this discussion. History and definition, and I hope some of you will learn some things here. Jazz is an expressive art form that received its name early in the 20th century. And I want to throw in before I forget, I guess as someone who plays a lot of jazz, I kind of resent when someone thinks there are still people who think jazz is just faster, louder, out of tune. You know, that's just not right. That's just not fair. And maybe that's the history of it being played late nights in dance halls. But true jazz as an art form is not just meant to be. Now, yes, there are very expressive groups that maybe play outside the box. That Charles Mingus, for example, you know, some of his groups, they didn't care about information. It was fairly obvious when you listened to them. That wasn't the point. Yeah, you get into the what art is. I think the debate is art versus maybe entertainment, and that's the danger, I think, of jazz. Maybe there are people, maybe even in this room, who consider jazz to be, it's just for swing dances. I guess I'm someone to say that it's not just for that. That's part of its world. Combining African rhythms and European harmonies, jazz has given us blues, ragtime, Dixieland swing, bebop, post-bop, cool, free, fusion, Latin jazz, and other crossover varieties. I've heard of phrases like funky is a style. I saw some video that I'd never heard this term. I don't know. The style of funky supposedly was like the hard bop era, but that was one filmmaker's term for that period. Mostly known for improvisation, the ability of its players to spontaneously create related and new melodies and harmonies. One very great example you can use with your students is what I'm doing right now is extemporaneous speech. I'm not reading, and yet I have some command of the English language, and so I'm sharing ideas with you. Well, that's not that far removed from what Jack and I just did on those tunes. I learned the boundaries and borders, the roadmap of a song, so sometimes it helps to relate it to students through another way. That I'm not reading a speech right now. We can talk, we can come up with things spontaneously. Jazz was the pop form of music from the 20s into the 40s. I have a friend who drives me crazy sometimes. He's a fantastic jazz player, but he says jazz shot itself in the foot when bebop started. And I said, what are you talking about? He said, well, it went away from the masses. And his debate there is more about entertainment versus art. I think the bebop players took it to a new level that, yes, maybe wasn't accessible, but now we're debating about art. We're not debating about what was popular. So, you know, you can get into that whole discussion. Jazz is a pure art, but also has a history of functioning well as a type of entertainment, and therein lies, I sometimes think, lies in the danger of art debates, because it depends on how you look at jazz. Our setting for this discussion is I would encourage all band directors, if you're not already doing so, to offer some or any type of jazz instruction. I'm going to assume that most of you in the room offer something, and that's the thing about speaking to a group like this, incredibly diverse. Maybe some of you don't have time or don't have an opportunity. To some of you have the finest jazz program in your state, and I have no clue, you know, who all those are, but that's kind of what we figure we're talking to today. If you're looking to start up a jazz group, let me cover that quick, and this is true for anyone, you will find the greatest variety of published music available to you by establishing the rhythm section as the most important section. As a horn player, I remember as a young man regretting that and being a little mad about how important the rhythm section was, but it's just where the heart and soul of the group is. yes, you can play jazz without a rhythm section, but you have just closed off about 95% of the literature to yourself. You're going to be arranging all the tunes. There are wonderful groups like the Hornheads, Nozzle Brass, which is this group in Germany that's really a kick. If you can get online and put in M-N-O-Z-I-L, the Nozzle Brass, they're really funny. They don't use a rhythm section. Youngblood Brass, Brass Nation, these are groups that don't use a rhythm section, so it's possible, but I would say anyone who's getting started in this, you better feed and fuel your rhythm section and do whatever you have to do to find those people in your building. I'm not talking about just your bands. If someone can play bass, if someone can play a drum set, if someone can play vibes or piano, bring them in. Let's see. Let me continue on. Most of your percussionists can be taught to do simple swing in Latin. Most of you guys can teach them in 10 minutes. If you can have someone sit at a hi-hat and get them to play swing beats. If you can't get them to play swing, then do some easy rock or Latin things. You know, you can get some to play straight eighth notes on a hi-hat. Find those piano players anywhere in the school. You can teach them simple chords. Jack's going to talk much more about piano in a bit here. I use keyboard bass when I have to. I guess I know people in my state who are purists, and they say, no, you must have four trumpets in your trumpet section, and you must have five saxes. Well, I'm not the other side of that. I've seen bands with 40 kids on stage, and there's, you know, 19 saxes who really can't play in tune. That may be redundant, isn't it? But I don't believe in that either. But I believe in, you know, you got to reach the kids. So if I have seven kids who can play sax and are interested, then I bring seven kids into the section. Or if I have eight. But after that, it does get tough. I don't really try to push it much beyond that. Bass can be tricky, obviously, for all of us to try to find a bass player. What I do is I teach middle school, 6 through 8. At the end of every 7th grade band year, I find two kids, and there always are two, who want to play, and I pay for half their lessons from the band fund for that next summer to get them prepped for the fall, and then I continue to pay for half from the band fund for lessons to just keep them up, and that's how I do it. It works for me, and then some of those kids give it up after 8th grade jazz band's done, and some, wow, they go on, you know, and they thank me for it later, that they ever got started and had some decent instruction. I'll try to move past you guys. Guitarist is another issue. And my first question to guitar players is when I get a little 6th grader who comes up to me and says, can I be in the jazz band? I said, I would love to have you in the jazz band. Do you know how to play chords that are in the flat keys? And that usually scares most guitarists away, of course, because they can play in the sharp keys so well. And so if that's the first question. And they can go to their teacher and say, can you teach me some, like an F7 chord or an E-flat 9? I mean, all of a sudden these little guys are trying to learn those slightly more elevated concepts. Let's see. Do you have a more advanced percussionist that can get you that you can get them onto the vibes? You can teach them simple chording. Be flexible on all that. Articulation. Jack and I talked. We realized late in our correspondence that we really should address that because it's just huge. A very important style characteristic is how to deal with articulation. As a rule, what would get you on the right track is to listen, listen, and listen to great bands, and you're going to hear that several times. But it would also help to have your wind players learn to, when performing swing music in particular, play groups of eighth notes, tonguing the first note, and then all upbeats. It's a weird concept if you've never talked about this. This is what we kind of call jazz articulation in the pedagogical world. I hope that sounds fairly clear, and one of the reasons is that I'm tonguing only upbeats. I'm tonguing all upbeats. If I play it slurred, sounds okay, but I think it creates that natural syncopation if you just tongue the upbeats. Some kids try to swing too hard. I mean, how many bands do you hear? And I tell kids, don't try to swing so hard. You're just trying too hard. Can you just relax, just tongue the offbeats. Don't even think about working that hard. And then Jack and I talked about, and I would love to hear more input, is some of the instruction I've had over the years feel that articulation changed somewhat by the bebop era. I shouldn't say articulation, I should say rhythm. The eighth notes straighten out a little bit. After Basie and the great bands of the 30s and 40s, had their heyday, kind of, when bebop started and I think it was more of a speed issue. When you get faster, you have to straighten out your eighth notes, right? You can't really roll those eighth notes anymore. So it was more speed, but I think it stuck with the style. And I think modern contemporary swing is a little more straight, but that would be great to get input on that. I'll try to keep pushing on. Tunes like, well, let's see. Well, that's a jazz bebop tune. I didn't use jazz articulation. Now if I add jazz articulation. Whatever. It just makes it swing a little better, a little more clear. And at high speeds, I think I can sound a little more coherent, I guess might be a good word for it. Note speak, if I use that tonguing. Questions or comments on that? I think I provided a great page for you on page 2. I have worked hard on that. I actually run a big band up there. We're a nonprofit tax exempt. It's called the Big Band Jazz Orchestra, and the people in my big band, adults, help me put this page together. Would love to hear updates, additions. I know we left somebody out. It's always debatable, naturally. But I intended to make it a one-page handout. I think you can use this with your students and hopefully get them to listen. Now, I notice I have a box on the left side, some top big bands, and of course, most of you will teach big bands. That just seems to be a convenient way that we instruct children, right? And I guess that's the main argument we can use to teach big bands. If someone debates, why are you teaching big band jazz? Well, that's a way we reach large students, a large number of students. And there's certainly additions we can put on here. It was sad that Michael Brecker died in the last year, and I had to move him to the other list. He's a favorite player of mine. Questions or comments on that page? I'll try to keep my end of the bargain up. Jack will keep moving. The next pages, guys, I'm certainly not going to read you. This is provided as just tools for you. I would prefer you not read it now and read it later on. I can tell you that these are from friends of mine who just are great players and are great educators in Minnesota, so they are not just kind of highfalutin jazzers who don't really care about what's going on. These are caring people. You'll notice the range of answers is very interesting because there are some extended answers and there are some very short. All fine players, and none of them would mind being notified. And I didn't want to reinvent the wheel. You notice I just went to my best playing friend and said, look, can you give me some background? And rather than me just reinventing it and bringing it to you. So I would ask you to check those out. Why did I provide that? Well, we're band directors. A lot of us don't know much about it. What am I going to do about that guitar sound? Holy cow, the kid sounds like he's, you know, just playing heavy metal, and you got to do something about that. One of the things I was encouraged there is that he said, don't have your kids buy new equipment. They don't have to go buy a hollow body guitar for your jazz band. You know, you can make the stuff work that you have. So please check that out later. I'm going to go past that. Several pages of resources for you on other instruments. Can you find developing the ear? I think it's on your page 8. I kind of have a different blown up handout here. But page 8, developing the ear. Let's get into some of these and what we're really talking about. In some ways, some of you know what Jack and I were doing a moment ago doesn't have a lot to do with what you do with 8th graders in your room. And you know what I mean? Because you're managing kids, and they can't do that, those kind of things. I mean, those are higher level jazz activity. So where do you start? Well, why should everyone enjoy some of the traditional components of jazz? And I'm guilty of this. Only recently in my teaching have I even started to use some of these with my concert band, and I feel kind of bad about that. Why? Why did I avoid for years doing ear training with kids? Why did I avoid having them play tunes by ear? It's silly. Use ear training exercises with all of your students, including concert band. Here's some strategies for getting younger students to develop their ears and become more fluent on their instruments. And that's a term I would use with advanced kids, fluency on your instrument, just as if I'm speaking now here. I hopefully am fluent in my language, and we want to get that same on our instrument, whatever it may be. Rhythmic work can be first. And I guess I had a plan. I can do rhythmic work, and maybe if we get time, I'll do it. I would actually have students, I'd pick a quarter of the group to do something like this. And then I would have a quarter of the group maybe do it. Get that kind of stuff going and have a quarter of the group go, or they could just vocalize it. Do those kind of things and then get another quarter group and you all of a sudden have a little rhythmic band going. That's great. Even fifth graders love that. I've been teaching fifth graders last year for the first time, which is kind of new for me. Got assigned that recently. But it's turned out to be fun. I might come back to that more later, but I just want to watch the time. Pitch matching, and this is a great one. Play a note on your, have you ever tried this? Play a note on your horn and try to get your band to find that note. That's a tough skill. I never had to do that when I was in seventh grade. I wish my director would have done stuff like that, but most kids are, you know, they're nervous about it. I tell them, you can only make 12 mistakes, right? Yeah. So, you know, and I tell them, you have my permission to make mistakes. Go ahead and make some mistakes. We're going to try this, and I'll turn around so the tenor saxes don't see me, right? And I'll just say, you know what? perfect. And they'll try for a long time, and then I ask the kids who find it, I just ask them to stop playing, because, of course, there's just mayhem in the room, and I'll keep, and I'll walk around and try to get the kids to find it. And first couple days, that's just awful. Be ready for awful sounds. And some of them will actually think they have, and they don't. And you just got to be patient with that and say, if you keep playing at them, that'll help, but just don't push them too hard. And another day, they may find it better, as their peers find it. Sometimes it takes that kind of work. Let's see. Call and response would be a next step. So now that you found that note, just use that same note. Can we try it, Jack? And I tell the kids, we're going to play, I'm going to be in the 4-4 time, and I'm going to play something that's 4 beats long and have to respond. He's got it. And that kind of thing, you know. And then that's just swing style. And don't stick yourself just to swing. I mean, try other varieties, straight beat, Latin rock, whatever. Okay? And of course, from there, you get a little more sophisticated, right? Now I'll take a scale and do that same idea. We're going to move up the scale, but I'm going to play one full measure for you of a rhythm, and you have to copy me, and then we'll do 3-4 time, how about? And then, of course, you know the next step is to get a student to do that, which can be tough. Because there's 4 hands that they want to do everything. Those kids want to play all the time, and you have to watch out for that. But I'll have them lead the way. I was amazed this last spring what some kids did, the use of space. Some kids would try to bait the other kids. I was surprised at the reaction, as I kind of prepared for this a little more. Let's see, playing by ear, and I love this. Try this in your band room sometimes. Just say, can anybody play a song for me without any sheet music? You can't use any sheet music. And I thought, well, maybe no one will do anything, but middle schoolers, you know, a bunch of hands went up, and all of a sudden they're playing tunes for me. They probably learned them in the book, whatever. But there's always a few kids in the room. It's always amazing. They can pick things up. I've been fortunate. I've had an amazing pianist. I'll never have a student like this again. I just had an 8th grader this year that could play a whole ton of standards by ear. It was amazing. He played classical, so I'm sad to see him go, but I'll have to follow him through high school and see how his development is. But I'll tell kids, could you play, 3 Blind Mice for me? It starts on the 3rd note of your B-flat concert scale, and some brave souls will say, okay, I'll try it. You know, they'll start to figure it out. They'll work through it. And that's just great ear training. You know, you may think that's insignificant, but wow, they're starting to relate something from their brain to their horn. And it really does have something to do with jazz playing. Because ultimately, and I wish I'm still working to be there, but, you know, great jazz players don't, there's no secondary thought process. It just whatever's here comes out there. That's more like Jack play. It's not like me. I'm trying to get there. But it's just amazing. And that's what we're starting as a goal for our young students, if we're really going to study the art of jazz. Let's see, and there's a ton of tunes I have listed there for you. I think those are great ones to ask your kids, Yankee Doodle, because they're tunes that everybody supposedly knows. We think everyone knows those. If you have more to add, or please let me know. And then finally, jamming a little bit, and you'll have kids who'll do this, especially I've had great success with middle school. I haven't taught high school for a while, I guess I've taught camps, and kids there, of course, are real motivated, and they're coming to get instruction on jazz. But in a general high school concert band, I haven't tried this, so I'm curious what reaction. But if I turn to the trumpets, let's pretend Jack is the trumpet section. Can you give me a B-flat concert chord? Let's go 1-3-5, flat 7, right? And I'll tell the trumpets, you know, C, E, G, B-flat. Can you go I'll have taught them the B flat concert dominant scale already. Can you do that pattern? Close that pattern. So then I asked them to just mess around. I'm just trying to get them to noodle around on their horn and get used to playing a dominant scale, you know, and hopefully you'll be surprised at what they come up with. Some kids really get lost quick because they don't use the B flat concert scale anymore, but we try to get them to use those tools anyway, and that's jamming to a little vamp like that. You pick a pattern, doesn't have to be swing again. I shouldn't just accentuate the swing. Teaching improvisation, tools for students. And if you've already done a lot of the stuff we're just talking about, you're on your way. Having already done the exercises listed above with your students, we look at actually getting into the creative process of creating new related melodies and harmonies. Remember, that's what improvisation is. There's a nice quick definition for you to remember. Creating new related melodies and harmonies. To continue here, you need a rhythm section, or at the very least a chordal instrument and drums to accompany some solo or group solo activity, and I'll explain that a little bit more in a minute. As performers, performers and authors like Jim Snyder, some of you might know, and others, they prefer modal tunes are the easiest way to get started. Some of you might know, like John Coltrane and Miles Davis started using tunes with a one chord structure. Some of them had an AABA form that just moves up a half step. But those are the easiest tunes, obviously, a one chord. There's really no chord changes, so to speak. So tunes like Impressions. Kids. I mean, that's all I do. I use it as a head chart. I don't even go to the key change on the bridge, the B section. And that's the best way to get started. But of course, then you get, you know, the blues is talked about a lot. I would say that modal is the easiest way to go if you can look up tunes like Impressions. So What is more of a bass solo. Some people mention that. It's still a decent tune to use, but that would be a bass type solo or somebody soloing on that main melody. But we get into the blues. You almost have to get into the blues at some point. The kids like it. And that's your first simple chord changes, right? Actual chord changes, three chords. Pretty easy structure. You find a 12-bar concert B-flat blues tune and get a bass player to at least play the roots in quarter notes, right? You can get someone to go boom, 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 E-flat, 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 E-flat. They don't have to walk a line yet, you know? That is a whole art within itself. So we can't expect students to connect chords yet. Just get them to play roots. They can read those off the page. It just says B-flat in there, right? It says E-flat. And of course, a lot of you have kids who play way above that. I'm taking it from ground zero there and giving you some ideas and hope to get some feedback from you. Rhythmic improvisation. Don't forget about rhythm. I think kids hear people play flashy and they forget about. Yeah, that's kind of a rhythmic motive. I guess don't let them get away from using rhythm. Rhythm is the most important thing in music. I think you all know that. That's what I always tell my kids. It doesn't matter how beautiful your tone is if you can't play it at the right time. I said, it doesn't matter if you play all the right notes if they're at the wrong time, right? Rhythm is most important, so don't forget to accentuate that with them. I'll try to watch my time here, Jack. Let's see. Let me move on. Limited note group. Oh, I want to say, if I get to a point in my band rehearsal where I feel like I really want to get kids soloing, I want to push that jamming idea, right? And I can see that they're resistant. Then I'll just say, trombones, I want you all to play. And they'll look at me funny, and I'll have the rhythm section going, and I'll just say, just play. You got to play. I told you what you can use. And then they'll kind of look at each other, and they'll start noodling. You know, they don't want to do it alone. But if you can just get them in safety in numbers, right, the schooling instinct, at least they can play without feeling so naked to everybody, right? They can play in a group. And that seems to work. I haven't had much problem with that. Let's see. I'll have to skip things quickly. Limited note group from blues. Let's take blues as an example. You guys know there are common tones to all those three chords. That's one way. There's a limited group. The root, the second, the fourth, the fifth, and the sixth are notes that are used in every one of those chords. So you can get your students to play that kind of an odd scale, pentatonic scale, an altered pentatonic type, and they can just noodle with that over, and they'll never sound really bad. Some notes will be a little odd. You get a fourth in there on something and that kind of thing that want to be settled a little bit. Let's see, then we're starting to get a little more sophisticated now, moving on into finding key centers. Now when you get into a more sophisticated tune, one shortcut, some of you know songs will have, like All the Things You Are, actually covers several keys. If you're teaching that to a student, that's pretty hard, but I'm just saying there are key centers. At least you can simplify a 2-5-1. You don't have to really teach them a 2-5-1, you can teach them a 1. So little shortcuts. And they can, you know, that's going to sound fairly consonant. You don't have to teach them all the tensions and substitutions from day one, right? The final one, of course, is you get into reading chord changes on sophisticated tunes, and then you're going to have to give students some theory lessons, 9th, 11th, 13th, the upper extensions. With my advanced students, I call it building chords, making scales. You know, we spell out all those chords, and we say, wow, look at this. If you rearrange them, it's just a scale. Now you get into flat sixes and all that stuff, and it gets a little complicated, and then how the melody relates to that, chord changes. Last thing is, I have a little list for you there of of easy head charts, and if someone's never heard that phrase, it's just teaching students to tune by ear, which I think is a great tool. I kind of stayed away from it for a while early in my career, and I thought, why am I avoiding that? And I think those are somewhat in order of difficulty. If you're interested, Blue Train. I just jumped into the wrong key project. But the I think those are, let me know if you think that's a little out of line, but it does, I don't know, I didn't really have that. I don't know if that's truly an order of difficulty or not. But any questions, comments about my part of the presentation so far here? Yes?
Randy, everything's fine until we get to the vibe player. His instrument in C, playing it, any of the flat keys are terrible in the beginning. The chords they have to do in a four balance are just horrendous. So if we get the percussionist or the vibe player into C and get him through the six chords, seven chords, and so on, before we get into the key of F and then move into the key of B flat, when he gets there, he's really going to have all these problems he has to deal with. And at that point, he gets very concerned, somewhat discouraged, because he can't keep up with the rest. So if the vibe player started ahead of time with 12-bar blues, simple things like that, and improvising, everything that you said really helps. And I've learned that through experience, dumb experience, okay?
Well, it's kind of preparing for success, right? So if you know you're going to start a jazz group, you better get that vibe player some instruction or some help.
Right. And one of the greatest things to do is you can do that on marimba, you can do it on xylophone until you get to vibes and pedaling. But at least that gets them oriented with two and four mallets, and they learn bass parts, they learn guitar parts, they learn how to comp, all those things, gamma parts, before they even get into being a part of a full group.
Thank you.
Very well done. I'm a real contrast to Randy, and that he sort of trained through college and so forth. I'm what they call a street musician. When I was a kid, I ended up playing in Cleveland and in the bars and whatever was happening. And I was very fortunate they let me play. They wouldn't let me solo. They let me play because I could play the changes. But all these really fine young players in Cleveland at the time were letting me be involved. So I did get an early start at it. And I think my teaching sort of reflects playing a little bit. What this clinic, too, as well as improv, of course, was getting your band ready to play a festival or whatever. And so the front page of mine starts out with the setup. I went in to visit a group in Florida. I'm in Florida now, and I got around and tried to help all the bands in the county. And the one set up in the rhythm section was over here, complete, but over on this side of the band. And wow, what do you do? I said, well, you know, ordinarily the rhythm section's on stage right, you know, on this side, so you face. Well, we really like it this way. Well, that's fine. But traditionally, your band is going to set up with your rhythm, if I'm facing them, conducting them. The rhythm section is here, and then the three rows. Now, we went through a period with the Stan Kenton band where he had saxophones, trombones, trumpets behind him, rhythm section in the middle. I even did that with my saxophone once. The judge says, boy, your clarinet sounds good. The judge over there says, boy, your trumpet sounds good. Didn't work at all, the theory of phonic sound. Anyway, basically, if you use a traditional one, you'll probably be better off, but I certainly am not going to criticize any. The main thing is, most of my comments are from what I've seen as a judge. The bass player has to put his bass up on a chair, and he has to not turn it out to the audience like you would in a rock group, through the band. We don't have enough contact from the rhythm section to the band. Therefore, it should be there. It should also be next to the hi-hat. Because if I'm rehearsing, I'll just have, okay, hi-hat and bass play. And the band, oh, okay, this is where we are. Too many times, sit down, play my part, you know. But it's not, you know, you've got to get this rhythm section involved, and that does help. Also, the rhythm section has to be able to see each other. Okay, that might be, you say, well, that's only for a dance. No, they need to start from the very beginning, looking at each other, listening to each other, listening to the soloist. Your band need to listen to the soloists as they're playing and respond to that.